This video is a virtual anatomy lecture series directed by Dr. Strategy using anatomy table. The manipulation and the annotation was done by Dr. Maiba Chuong. The English script was monitored and recorded by Ms. Soyeon Kim, the PhD candidate. You can learn human anatomy easily with SNUSD Knowledge Share Initiative.
Let's continue with the bones of the upper limb. The shoulder girdle and free bones of the upper limb form the superior appendicular skeleton. Let's start with the shoulder girdle first. The shoulder girdle is also called the pectoral girdle, and it is a bone ring incomplete posteriorly. The shoulder girdle is formed by two sets of bones, the scapulae posteriorly, the clavicles anteriorly, and completed anteriorly by the manubrium of the sternum. The clavicle or the collar is an S-shaped long bone lying superficially and is palpable along its entire length. The body or the shaft of the clavicle has a double curve in a horizontal plane. Its medial half is convex anteriorly. And its sternal end is enlarged and triangular, where it articulates with the manubrium of the sternum at the sternoclavicular joint. The conoid tubercle near the acromial end of the clavicle gives attachment to the conoid ligament. The medial part of the coracoclavicular ligament here. Other surface markings of the clavicle include the trapezoid line, which gives the trapezoid ligament attachment here. The subclavian groove is an indentation that runs horizontally along the inferior surface of the bone from the costal tuberosity in yellow to conoid tubercle in green here. It serves as an attachment for the subclavius muscle. More to the medial side is the costal tuberosity, also called the impression for the costoclavicular ligament, a tough, often depressed oval area that gives attachment to the ligament binding the first rib to the clavicle. This is the costoclavicular ligament. Let's continue with the scapula. The scapula or the shoulder blade is a flat bone that lies on the posterolateral aspect of the thorax, overlying the 2nd to the 6th or 7th ribs. It articulates with the clavicle at the acromioclavicular joint and with the humerus at the glenohumeral joint. The scapula is a triangular flat bone. The costal surface of the scapula here faces the rib cage. It contains a large concave depression over most of its surface, known as the subscapular fossa. The subscapularis originates from this fossa. Originating from the superolateral surface is the coracoid process. It is a hook-like projection which lies just underneath the clavicle. Three muscles attaching to the coracoid process are the short head of the biceps brachii muscle, coracobrachialis muscle, and the pectoralis minor muscle. The lateral border of the scapula faces the humerus. There are some important bony landmarks here. The glenoid fossa is a shallow cavity located superiorly on the lateral border. It articulates with the head of the humerus to form the glenohumeral joint. The supraglenoid tubercle is a roughening immediately superior to the glenoid fossa. It is the place of attachment of the long head of the biceps brachii muscle. The infraglenoid tubercle is roughening immediately inferior to the glenoid fossa. It is the place of attachment of the long head of the triceps brachii muscle. The dorsal surface of the scapula faces outwards. It is marked by the spine, infraspinous fossa, supraspinous fossa, and the acromion. The spine is the most prominent feature of the posterior scapula. It runs transversely across the scapula, dividing the surface into two infraspinous fossa and supraspinous fossa. The infraspinous fossa is the area below the spine of the scapula, and it displays a convex shape. The infraspinatus muscle originates from this area. The supraspinous fossa is the area above the spine of the scapula. It is much smaller than the infraspinous fossa and is more convex in shape. The supraspinatus muscle originates from this area. The acromion is the projection of the spine. That articulates with the clavicle at the acromioclavicular joint.